Hello.
Hey.
Hi.
Oi, oi.
Hello. All my life's a circle, sunrise and sundown. The moon rose through the nighttime, till the daybreak comes around. All my life's a circle, but I can't tell you why. Seasons spin around again, years keep rolling by.
We drove 3 hours from the northwest suburbs of Chicago up to Wisconsin Dells. We passed the signs advertising Kalahari and Noah's Ark, and we turned down a winding gravel path that wove between trees. And there it was, Camp Shy. This was the summer between my 7th and 8th grade year. I was 13 years old, and I had no idea what the summer had in store for me. I'd been coming to Camp Shy since I was 9 years old, and every summer was a real learning experience. The other campers mostly went to the area public schools, and so a lot of them knew each other from their non-camp lives. I, on the other hand, went to this weird little private school in the western burbs. It was a little gifted school called Quest Academy, and I had been going there since kindergarten. And all of my friends I had known basically since kindergarten. So I had no idea how to socialize with people my own age who I didn't know already. I had no idea. What I did know was how do you impress adults? And I knew how to make myself the center of attention. So every summer I would bring, I don't know, 20 books for 4 weeks in my duffel bag. Anytime it rained, I would run outside and scream and dance and splash in the mud. And I kid you not, every single year, I brought a thesaurus to camp. And the purpose of this was so that I could devastate my camp nemesis with really inventive insults that she didn't understand. I would say to her, "You are fatuous dolt." And she would say, "I don't know what that means." And I would say, "Exactly." So you might imagine that I wasn't very popular.
Get out.
And you would be correct. I wasn't popular. But I really do love the kid that I was back then because I was fearless. And my counselors always took a liking to me. And the other kids in my cabin, even if they didn't really want to be my friend, they wanted to fix me. So Morgan taught me how to shave my legs. Molly would lend me nicer clothes to wear for Shabbat. Alana at one point took my thesaurus and tried to throw it into the lake. And throughout all of this, I would always laugh. And I would laugh first, and I would laugh loudest, and I would laugh longest. Because I knew that if I was, you know, laughing at myself, then they couldn't really laugh at me. So the summer that I was 13, the summer between 7th and 8th grade, I got it into my head that I was going to be friends with the popular group of my cabin. So there were these four girls, Jacqueline, Jessica, Sherry, and Marissa. And they all knew each other. They had all grown up in Deerfield, Illinois. They were all friends from school. And they just had their own thing going on. And I found all of them really interesting, really compelling, and I wanted to be around them. And so our cabin, when we went from like the dining hall to the swimming pool, they would hang back from the rest of the group, and they would walk and talk in their group together. And I figured that if I just hung around them and annoyed them with a fly, then they would have to like me. And so that was what I did. If they were talking about the activities that they were going to sign up for, I would just like be there and I'd be like nodding and I'd be like, "I'm going to sign up for Arts and Crafts too, I'll see you there." If they were talking about music, I would be like, "Yeah, I don't like my humps. What does Fergie think she is, a camel?" And I was so annoying. worked. And they started letting me sit with them at lunch, and during our rest hour, they would invite me to play cards with them. And it was amazing. Like, I had friends at camp and friends my own age, and it was really wonderful. And then Sherry got a boyfriend, and all the other girls were really excited for her, and I was not. Out of our little group, I considered Sherry my best friend. She was effortlessly good in every single sport. At the age of 13, she had mastered sarcasm. And she could really pull off a pair of basketball shorts, which I respected because at that age I was already pear-shaped. And Sherry, in my mind, was my best friend. And Brad, this guy Brad that she was dating, he was an interloper. And so I remembered that I had won Sherry over by annoying her. And so I figured that I could bring her back to me by annoying her. And so I would follow Sherry and Brad around and really be a pest to them. They would be like hanging out together during an open swim at the pool, and I would follow them around and splash them with water. We would have campfire song circles, and they'd be sitting there and they'd be cuddling, and we'd be singing like Free Falling or like some Perry Chapin song. And I would creep up behind them, and I would sing Kiss the Girl from Little Mermaid, like really loud right at them. It was a huge mood killer. And when all of that didn't work, I decided to start a no boyfriends club. And my plan with this club was that if I had a club and you couldn't be in it unless you didn't have a boyfriend, then Sherry would dump Brad and be in my club. And it didn't work. It was a club membership of one. I couldn't get anyone else to join my club. And that didn't stop me. I became more and more militant about it. One night, I was delivering an impassioned sermon about the evils of boys. Are you a lesbian? And for the first time, I didn't have an immediate response, and I felt my stomach just turn to stone and stammered out, no, no. And it was a little too little and a little too delayed, a little too after the fact. And my counselor, Missy, broke the tension. She said, lights out, everyone in bed. And I climbed up my bunk, and I got into my sleeping bag, and she turned off the lights, and I laid in bed, and I couldn't sleep for hours. Just hours. And the next day, I wasn't just the weird kid from the weird school. The other girls in my cabin, when they got back from the showers and were about to get dressed, they would say, don't look, I'm changing! And there was a girl from another cabin who told me that I couldn't play sharks and minnows with them anymore because she didn't want me to tag them. And I pretended that this didn't affect me. And it's not like I was completely alone, because there were other kids that would let me play with them. And, you know, I could always just bury myself in a book. But every night I would get into bed and I would time travel. And I would go back to that moment where Jessica leveled her accusation. And I would think of different things that I could have said in response to avoid this timeline. Or I would go back further and think, okay, I should never have started the No Boyfriends Club to begin with. That's how this all started. And I would go back even further and think, this is what you get for trying to be friends with people. You know, I shouldn't have talked to them to begin with. And at the end of the summer, we had a dance. And it was with the boys from our unit, the boys of our age group. And it was held in the rec cabin. And it was after dark. The room was dark. It was hot. The music was very, very loud. And I just sort of stood against the wall, like hugging the wall. And I had my cup of bud juice. And I just stood there and I sipped my bud juice. And I had no idea what to do with myself. And someone started a grind chain, which is what 13-year-olds were doing in 2006. And I felt just completely overwhelmed. And so I left the cabin, and I went outside, and I sat down by the campfire, and I watched the embers from the fire float up and extinguish against the night sky. And I sat there and I breathed. And then a couple minutes later, my counselor, Missy, came out and she sat down beside me on the bench. And she didn't say anything for a few minutes. And we just sort of sat there. And then she leaned in and she whispered to me, sort of conspiratorially, she said, "I don't like boys either." And, you know, in retrospect, you know, maybe it was just kind of, you know how adults condescend to kids? And they're like, "Yeah, boys have cooties." And it's quite possible that that's what that was. I think it's also possible that she saw me and she wanted me to see her. And it's the age of social media, and, you know, I could reach out to her, I could ask. But, you know, I don't want to, because, you know, I don't want to know the truth, because I feel like that will shift my memory of that interaction. You know, I don't want to know. So, the summer ended, I got through it, I went back home, I went back to my weird little school for one more year. And then the following year, I was going into high school, so I didn't go back to camp. I did the things that kids do when they're going into high school. And I didn't go back to camp after that. And, you know, when I think back on that, and I think back on that, you know, every summer around Pride Weekend, you know, I think back about on who I was when I was at camp, and who I was when I was at little. And, you know, in many ways, I haven't really changed. I still love words. I still love running outside in the rain. I still love attention. I still develop crushes on, you know, sarcastic tomboys. You know, in many ways, I think I have, you know, it wasn't easy, but I did go from being this, you know, scared, closeted kid at Jewish camp to, you know, semi-functioning adult. I think I am still afraid of people seeing through me in the way that Jessica saw through me. And I think that might be why I do this, why I do storytelling. So that I can control how you see me before you look at me and decide what box to put me in. So I started this story with a little snippet of a song that we used to sing at camp. It's called Circle by Harry Chapin. And